Lose my point, right, doing this dance. Doesn't matter. Alright, so for the next presenter, we have on project discovery, which is, of course, a very, very interesting topic in Eve. Today, we have Udarian Fondan, who's going to be telling us all about this.
Yay!
I'm not that happy. Well, I think it's beautiful, but you know, the difference. Welcome to the presentation on Project Discovery. I'm Udarian Fondan. To give a bit of background about myself, I joined up right after Asakai, after reading about it. Did some mining, because the NPE told me to. Luckily, that's changing now. Right after that, I went into some missioning, lost a few apocalypses, unfortunately. And after that, I did the founder more, which was quite funny, actually. I was on test site, so sorry to the people who are miffed about that. After that, I went with some work colleagues into Wormhole Space, which was actually quite fun. I'm still in that corporation, which you can see here, Art of Explosions. Those are made for Maze, of course. We decided today. Yes, we are recruiting. If I didn't tell that, my CEO would do nasty things. Involving turkeys. That's exactly Before the presentation, I would like to thank, of course, CCP for providing us with this minigame. Probably most of you people won't ever touch this game or have opened it, looked at it, and closed it. I hope to change some of your minds in this presentation. Secondly, MMOs, they provide the infrastructure, the API that delivers the images to the server of CCP. And they provided me with some unique data for this presentation, which will go up on their site after this talk. They have a blog with the numbers that we produce as players. The HPA, Human Protein Atlas, they are the scientists that provide the images, which they've scanned with microscopic stuff. Finally, Reykjavik University. The game itself was made by two students there for their final part of their study. I'm not sure, but CCP Wonderboy, that's the guy, he should be working still at CCP. I'm looking at Fossey, he is nodding. He still works there, that's nice to hear. Now, I hope he continues because he was very nice with feedback and great overall guy. So, why should I be telling you about Project Discovery, first of all? I just heard about it like the rest of us at in Vegas and the like. And when it hit Singularity, I just played it. It was during this one of my studies that was, I didn't have to do much work, so I played a lot of Project Discovery and liked it, put some feedback in. I did some podcasts and made a few videos about it, and generally, yeah, it was well received, so I was asked to do this presentation. I'm happy to do exactly that. So with that, let's get into the program for Project Discovery. Briefly, what it is, how it works, why you should do this. Somewhat important for most of the people here, I think. The results, these are the graphs that are provided by MMOs. And finally, the future of Project Discovery. And then there's room for questions. We have a mic set up there.
Much
you can do with that. First of all, let's start with the lore side before we get to the actual game. It's a system of a research project. Some of the people that do not only do the normal stuff that we are involved in lore. They might be keeping an eye on the Scissors OB. Also the Drifters and the Drifter Threat, they are being investigated by the Scissors OB. And what you're doing, Project Discovery, lore-wise, is, well, actually looking at the DNA of Drifters. So that has netted some nice results, as you will see later. So what we're doing is analyzing Drifter data in order to extract the Drifter tech and the weaponry that they have. Well, if you have seen the new player experience in Singularity, Drifters are involved there as well. So, yeah, you're welcome. This is thanks to Project Discovery. Finally, the science itself. We We have, on the science side of things, the categorization of protein patterns, why this is important. What we're doing is looking at cancer cells. They have taken those cancer cells and put a few special compounds in it that gives the images their colors. And they bind to specific structures, and those structures are what we are looking for. Now, if you have anything in biology, I certainly don't know anything about biology, thanks to Project Discovery, I know a bit about it, but it's all new for me. As you may know, you have DNA. DNA translates into something called RNA. I have no idea what it stands for, but that's what it does. And that forms proteins. And where those proteins are say something about the disease and how we can battle the disease. Unfortunately, many of us, well, our experience with people in our lives that have cancer, and Project Discovery is a real help to some of those, well, development of drugs that counter the disease. So some fairly good stuff that comes from it. It's important. And we do that by expanding the atlas that they have. These atlas is used as an open source database, basically, for scientists all around the world. They have hundreds of thousands, well, I should say tens of thousands, 150,000 users per month they have. They all draw from these atlases to power their research. So it's a real needy database, and we are adding to it. It's a good thing. And secondly, we have the concept of citizen science. Some of you may have played citizen science games before, like iWire or Foldit. Well, this is a new type of it. It's integrated into an existing game, what makes it, it gives a more steady player base. Often I've played iWire and Foldit myself, and I played it for a week. I've played Project Discovery a whole lot more than a week, so that's the power of this thing. Well, let's get into the game itself a bit, because many people have never seen this before. Or Dave, how many of you have never played Project Discovery? Can you see some hands? That's an awful lot. Who have tried it and closed it right after? Who are steady players? Oh, that's actually better than I thought. That's a good thing. As I said, we have those protein stainings that form structures. This is a part of the tutorial, as you can see here. What you need to do is classify the image that they provide to you, and they give a bit of feedback to help you with that there. And they tell you a bit about it. Tutorial is not that good, so you may look at it and think, I thought I had it right, but you didn't. And then you got sad and you quit. Which is often something that happens. And of course, because these players are scum of the earth sometimes, you see this number here in the corner that tells you something about which sample it is. This is only in the tutorial, it used to be in the game, but unfortunately, you can tell if it's a control sample, yes or no, and you can game the system, which is sad, you should all feel bad. Yeah, you did. I did too. Yeah, we have the options. This is just how the game itself works. We have a few options. First, the nucleus. If you've played the game, I will show a few images later. That's the blue bit, and everything that's green that's in there is part of the top layer. And then you have the cytoplasm. This is very confusing to a lot of people because there's also a structure that's called cytoplasm. Some say the only structure that you should ever annotate. That's wrong. That's the red part in the image, which you can see there. Then you have the periphery. That's actually all the green structures that are outside or at the edge of the red part. And finally, you have the MISC. So the cell variations, sometimes you have in one image multiple structures, but not in every cell the same type of structure, then you click that one and help science progress. And then the non-identifiable ones, which is well, basically only green. Sometimes it doesn't bind correctly and it just becomes a green haze. that's that, and sometimes it binds not at all, or so very, very low that you can't see anything in it, and you can select the negative one. So to help you a bit in the tutorial, they cross off a whole lot of options. It would be easier if you had a longer tutorial with more of this, because even this is not enough for most people actually to make it. Actually, this with some core mates on TeamViewer, it's apparently a lot harder than it looks. With that, you only have 10 samples that you have to do before you can start with the real database. And those 10 samples are very, very clear images of structures, which you think, after doing that, that you are perfectly ready for the game, which may not be the case, if you can see a bit. After you've completed the tutorial, you get Emma Lundberg, real scientist, as you know, and NPC in Eve. Maybe the first NPC ever that's also a scientist, I'm not sure, maybe. After you have done that, well, you're ready. You also only have to press one option every time, as you probably thought in the tutorial, and then you get your first image, and you're maybe a bit lost, actually, because there are four structures in this image. This project discovery players might see them all without switching the channels, which is something we'll get into later. So let's look at it from a project discovery point. The process I'm now going to explain takes me about 10 to 15 seconds. Others, minutes, hours, days. So first we have the nucleus. That's the part that's normally blue. In this case, the green overlaps the blue. So I have perfect paint skills, and I've selected all the nucleus bits. What we see here, it's always, for me at least, a smart idea to start with the nucleus and expand outwards, basically. So are there any project discovery players here who know what's in the green structure? That's circled here, or squared. I thought we had active... What? Almost. Nucleoplasm, which if you played it a lot, you would see, because there are a lot of these black holes into the green. If it's smooth, it's something else, just the nucleus. And we also have nuclear bodies. It's difficult to see on this slide, in the corner there. So you have sort of green bright specks, and there's a few of them. So we have two different things, just in the nucleus, and then we expand outwards. My paint skills are going up and up, as you see. There's the green part outside, the blue part, which you can see shining through the green here this time. And that's basically a smooth green structure without any real, well, I'd call it form, it's just green. And that is really cytoplasm. As you can see in here. And then we also have centrosomes. I don't know if anybody has seen that before. I don't think so, because we didn't even know what nucleoplasm was. There are basically these, I've squared them here, very bright green specks in the cytoplasm that overlap with a sort of knot of red. It's that hard. This takes me 10 seconds, and people days, actually. And when you have submitted that image, well, you get experience points and you get some ISK. This is all based on your accuracy. If you have max accuracy, which is 99, you get 99 experience points and 99K ISK. It's actually quite good money for a newbie that's mining. So tell the next, I will say Tuesday, but I hope the patch completes within that time. And then we see something interesting, actually, here in the corner. Anybody that's studied biology knows what it is. Nobody studied biology at all?
Nope.
Who's in IT? This is actually cell division, mitosis it's called. I have a gift that I hope works. It's 12MB, so basically it's a series of microscopic images, and two cells basically talk to each other. Exchange the correct DNA format and split into two new cells. This is growth. actually. This is cancer, so this is not good growth, actually. But that's how it works in a moving format. And because the images in protein discovery are stills, you won't see it moving, but you might see this face in one of the images as we could see in the previous one. So, how does protein discovery actually work behind the scenes? This is a very good scene on this slide of the sort of high-level architecture. I contacted the guys over at MMOs in order to obtain some data and their overview. Well, what's basically happening is you connect to the EVE client and the EVE client talks with their database, and there's no personal connection with their database. They're running on Amazon, you know them. And they also have a database for the researchers themselves, so they can look into the data and analyze it, which is important because they want to put it up on their site if it needs to be accurate. And if everybody selects cytoplasm, which happens, then, well, it's not good. So what they've done, the MMOs guys have supplied an API that talks to the service of CCP and their own service. They've done it because of security. They contemplated to just make their own, but that's too costly, and even players can be nasty. So it's just going through CCP's band, because they do security quite right, often. So the IP is not shown on their side of MMOs. Our character name is not shown. They only see the data that comes from CCP, and that's obfuscated. You can't take any out of it. In one of their first blogs, they talked about the top players, but they didn't know who it was. They had to send those data to CCP. CCP had to look up who those people were. So that's all done to protect your identity and not cause any problems on that side of things. Then you have the analysis credits, which is one of the rewards you get for project discovery. We'll get into that later. The rank and accuracy, there's all stored on CCP side. Yeah, they don't have any business with that over at MMOs. They're just the interest in the results and not in your rank, fortunately. Also, one thing of note is that they don't see accounts. I should say players, but only the accounts. I play on three accounts, and each account has a few players. So I account for three accounts, but I have 12 players. Nine players. So it's not very accurate sometimes in that regard. And then we have the science input. It's still from the background how it works. They deliver something that's confocal microscopy. I learned about this yesterday when I wrote the end of this presentation. I like procrastination like most people. They scan the images in order to bring them to us. So I've made here, again, a working moving image that gives a bit of an overview of how this works. This is how you see the image normally, and this is with an extra layer that we as players don't see. Well, first we have the blue part of the image, which should look about any second now. And in the blue part, that's the nucleus part, as I explained, then you have the cytoplasm section. That's the red part in this image. And then you have something called endoplasmic reticulum. Many people don't say that name right, and it's something very different. And it's basically a sort of yellow structure that surrounds every cell, but you do not see it in Project Discovery. There is a structure called with the same name, endoplasmic reticulum. And that layer is not added to the game because of bandwidth, actually. Because they use an RGB format to deliver the image, and the image is coming in, and you can select the different colors on the slide of the image. And because they don't have the yellow thing included, they could, but then you have heavier images for your connection. Actually, Project Discovery can take up a bit of
hard drive space,
indeed. They fixed that a bit. I had a few gigabytes of images stored on my PC at one time, until I deleted them all. So we use the RPG, but not the side, because, well, most of the structures don't have it, and you don't need it, so they just omitted it, because why not? So So why would you do project discovery if you can get a few rewards in the form of fancy medals? There are a few people that are way over these medal circuits, so we need new medals. Tip for the team. How high they are, you will see in a bit. So as I said, you get ace per sample. You do not get it per image, but per retin tick. You used to get it after each image, which is highly annoying, especially if you do a lot in a row. So now you get like 4 to 5 million each tick, which is nice. And it doesn't clog up your wallet, which is also annoying. You can also get analysis credits, which you can use to buy some apparel, combat suits and lab coats. Unfortunately, no beards. We tried, but we failed. Drifter boosters, I think most people think about Project Discovery, about these boosters. They're the most known because I've seen a lot of people fly with these boosters. They're 8% boost without drawbacks, so yeah. I've seen them on Guardians in World Space. I've seen them on missile platforms. Low-sec PvP uses a lot of drifter boosters, which I thank you for because it earns me money. And we also have facial augmentations, which nobody apparently knows about. It's sad. Who knew this? That we have facial augmentations? Two hands? 3, 4, 5? Less than 10. Yeah, they have a sort of bone structure and not unlike drifters. Well, there you go. Yeah, the combat suits are not on the market.
Only by
contract. So there's that. Then there's the lore rewards. Sometimes in the news you will see something about the Project Discovery. And as you can read here and in the one of the previous world news notes, Project Discovery is at least partially responsible for Alpha Clones. So again, you're welcome. We saved the game. Join us. finally, the science rewards, probably the most important part if you're concerned with that. There's some hardcore team players that don't care about the real life part. But it's important to the scientist. From all the data that we supply to players, and we have supplied a lot of data, they've compiled a new subcellular atlas, which is coming out pretty soon actually. And it will be used by scientists as a basis for their research. So that's we're very happy with that. As you can see, it's based on our provided data. Well, they use it by a lot of researchers as their source. So they can, based on this data, see patterns in the amount of localizations of protein structures. And based on that, they can say, well, if this structure is often here, this drug will alter it or move it and make the cell not grow, as we saw earlier. And if cancer is not growing and you destroy the rest, you have no cancer anymore. So it's pretty nifty to have. As I said, all the data is based on cancer cells that are grown in a lab, then microscoped in a sort of 3D way. It's a sort of slice of the cell that you see, which also means that sometimes it's out of focus. It's one of the small things about it. And it can lead to better treatments and drugs to battle cancer. Then one of the important parts, and really fun to see, you can see it in the graphs later also, but the integration of this game into an existing game, EVE Online, provides much more players in the end, as stable players, than a normal game on a website like iWire with the word downloadable like Foldit. But it creates a lot of people that are willing to try it at least, and even a few people that try it that know nothing about the game and well, do a lot of it wrong. If you can reach a consensus with each other, you can still help those research even if you don't know about it. That's one of the really useful thing. It's also more accessible science, as we learned, still not accessible enough for most players because the daily unique players is somewhat lower than you would like to see, as we see in a bit. It's also fun because instead of it being a standalone game, you can now integrate it into the game and create a bit of lore. I myself am very into the lore side of things, and to see it used as part of that, the Sisters of Eve, the Drifter, the Threat, all that, that's really that little bit extra that is also an incentive to play it. As I said, normally people will drop out, and that's, well, not the case now. So, what's also nice is you think about the game as being looking at cell biology, but it's basically just a frame which you could put multiple games in by just restructuring it. There's been talk of doing multiple projects, like one project per year, because we go through the data very, very fast. So when the project data is verified 3 or 4 times, as we did with Project Discovery, then you can move on to the next project within the same game. It gives a bit of a new edge, more players will join, and that's going to be good to have science. Unfortunately, there's also a few flaws, tutorial for example, but also the ranks and the reward system. It's basically a curve. It's tied to your accuracy, to your reward system. It's basically your rank times your accuracy in terms of a analysis credits payout. And the first 100 levels, that doesn't matter at all. And I think CCP didn't really expect people to go much higher than that so fast. But it means because the amount of samples you have to analyze doesn't increase as sharply. In fact, after a whole while, you reach about a maximum of 50 samples that you have to analyze, and not more. It means that you have to do the same work and get way more payout. And some people have profited very, very heavily on this. To give you a bit of an example, I have an alt that's on level 54. It gets 5k points, about that. Enough for a few drifting boosters, but you need 75k for a suit, which I used to go for 700 million, but now it's like 100 million. You can sell it for. But if you rank, well, somewhere in the 5,000, you get 500k AK for the same amount of images, almost. You can see that that's not very... it's broken, let's say like that. Because it reaches a point and it doesn't basically increase. So. After you go home and you play like one straight, you can get some good luck out of this, if you're patient enough. And of course it was exploitable, and of course we did something about that. because it was based on consensus, and if enough people had selected the same option, the system would mark that as the correct answer. But everybody selected the exact same structure over and over and over for every image. So the consensus reached for that protein structure, and well, everybody presses cytoplasm, cytoplasm becomes the answer. It's not, by the way. And yeah, ruined science, so don't feel bad. And the tutorial, yeah, it's simply not adequate enough. The tutorial is basically too easy for what you get after it, and it's too short. And the handholding is, well, it's written too scientific, I would say. A lot of people have looked at the sentence and are like, yep. Yeah. I don't know any of that, and press the next button and they quit. That's not nice. The AK market, analysis credit market, is basically broken because the items are basically indestructible, apparel, face instructions, only the boosters are sometimes destroyed, but they cost basically nothing. If you buy a booster for like 3 or 4K AK, but you get 500K a rank, yeah, you can see the market in no time. So yeah, more destructible modules, assist of each modules maybe, that would be nice. They tried it actually before of giving out straight loyalty points for the assist of Eve. It was not a good idea either, because that market would crash within a week. So they changed for some special items. And the most major flaw in some people's eyes is that the suits are still not tradable, so she should be pleased. That would be very nice. And then we have some results. If you have followed the presentations at EFanFest, they talked about some of this. I contacted them and asked, can I have some data for this presentation? Because you don't have anything on your blog at the moment, so could I kindly get the data? And I get a whole lot of Excel spreadsheets. So I got very happy and I made a lot of graphs. Then I deleted most of these graphs and kept the viewing. So if you take a look at the daily classifications, so this is the amount of images sampled per day. Well, you see an enormous spike of people who tried, and then they closed the game, basically. And then more and more people gave up, and basically we reached the baseline, around 30k. And this graph may look depressing at first, because it has such a sharp decline. But actually, that baseline provides a lot of data for the researchers, and it is a bigger baseline than a standalone game would have. So that's one of the nice things about this. And then we have the average amount of classification per player. I've put a trend line in here to show the increase as people get more experience in the game. They're able to do more classifications per the amount of time that they play Protein Discovery. If you're waiting for a fleet, for example, over the wormhole space and you're forming it, that takes a while. I'm looking at my CEO right now. then Protein Discovery is key to cover that time. On the internet because we're in-game browser. Then we have the unique players daily. Historic low there, about 490 people. And these are what's called by Attila from MMOs in his presentation, superstars. People who, well, they play an hour long and they do an enormous amount of images. So basically, over 30k images are sampled by only 500 people. So they're really into it. And even a small increase in this number provides an enormous boost in classifications and this contribution to science. These are unique accounts and characters. Second classification, we have 45. There's some data taken out of this, basically anything above 50 seconds, because if you open the game, start doing PvP and close it an hour later, then graph would be a bit skewed, and some people really take 5 to 10 minutes per sample. It's not good for you as a crowd, say it like that. But it's nice to see a bit of a down line. People get faster in the game, and that's good, because if you only play an hour a day, well, only, for me only, then the lower amount of time you're busy with one sample, the more samples you do an hour. And it's well, approaching 30 seconds, that's quite good. Then the total amount of players, so these are all players that have ever played Protein Discovery, or opened it at least, and completed the tutorial. It's important to say about that. And it's quite a good amount of people, it's 160k. So let's make that more coming a sentient patch. So what can we make of this? Well, we have reached the baseline, and the baseline is good. Good for science. We've completely destroyed their database a few times over, actually. They didn't expect that, I heard. No, I'm happy that we did. We see that dedicated players, they get faster, complete more samples per day. Huge, huge amount of data is being processed, and based on that, a new database has been opened coming December. That's very good. The amount of time, totally, up until 29th previous month was this amount of seconds. I'm not gonna say that because I'm Dutch. Minutes, hours, days, years. It's quite a bit, so to say. And that is basically, the bulk of this is done by a few players actually, who do a whole lot of Protein Discovery. Way too much to be healthy actually. I was one of those people. I've come back out of it a bit. Results. What you may not know is you have all those options that you have. Only 20 of those are actually real structures. The rest are, we think that is a structure options. And just put them in to hope that we click them and that they can say, yeah, this is a new type of structure that we haven't yet discovered this type of cancer cell. Some of these I will showcase. You have rods and rings, one of the rarest images you ever see. You have a database of a few million images. We found 103 of these. They are dead rare. And the confirmation of the existence of these tells something about the effectiveness of drugs in battling cancer again. So that's good. Then you have sometimes in biology something called the nucleoli. And they said, well, we give you a few options, like a nucleoli rim, which looks like this, and something like this. So we're basically refining some of the structures to be more accurate. And the more accurate you are, the more accurate you can help people who are sick with this disease. And then you have nuclear bodies, also one of the new structures. I talked to one of the HPA researchers yesterday. They've completed their experiments and are, as we speak, looking into the data now, and these are one of the few that they've confirmed are new structures thanks to Project Discovery. So that's quite a big of a milestone actually in science land. And as I said, there's also more, but we'll have to wait it out. Player results, or results, things that spawned around Project Discovery. The Indian channel, I set it up, there was none, and there's a steady amount of players there. Now these days it's mostly quiet, but sometimes there's a lively discussion about certain images. And then you have corporations that, they thought, let's build a corporation of Project Discovery and mining, because they just go very good together. And you have, previously there is one person, during FanFest they said it was probably a bot. It isn't, it's a very active player, just, I don't think anything else. And then when I asked him, he said, I'm about 3,500 at rank. And I thought, that's three times as high as he's doing FanFest. And he said, well, that's not actually, I don't want people to catch up with me, so I don't know my real rank. But for your presentation, I'll send you a screenshot. And he's rich, by the way. This guy, Javish, I would give him a shout out, called Mario. He has made over 130 billion on his game alone. That's a few super carriers. And he has the bulk of his analysis credits unspent, waiting for a new market, which he will crash immediately. So, single-handedly, I might add, I was happy with having 2 million analysis credits. He get that in four ranks. He's insane. Shout out. Probably one of the best players. Then the people of Human Protein Atlas were so kind as to provide a few lectures from the university. And people really enjoyed that. Those are rewatchable, if I'm correct. So it's nice for those people that are want to get into it. There's also a few instructional videos. I made a few myself. Probably you made a few. CCP itself has made one with Emma Lundberg, the NPC that we saw earlier, which gives a bit of background about Project Discovery and how you should go about it. Then we have a subreddit, also less salt here than in the subreddit. We have science here, and analysis, and happiness. Hydrostatic Podcast did a podcast on it. This was with the researchers and with a few in-game people. Check that. And then there's poetry. Because, of course, poetry. There was a contest for the best poem about Project Discovery. There were some very hilarious haikus about but this was one of the nicest ones. And actually, the one that organized the contest got sick and nobody ever got their rewards, and we were all sad. But we had some very nice poems out of it. And then let's talk a bit to the player, the party skull, so sent him some disc. Because he didn't get any. Then we have the, that's not me by the way, so. There would be a, yeah, I have another poem, so I wrong to put my own poem there. The future of Project Discovery, these are possible things in the future. Some of them are fixed, like the new Atlas that's coming out, which you should look into. Possibly new rewards would be very nice. As I said, destructible rewards that cost a bit of AK, you know, special missile launcher, or you know, capital armor, remote repairs, faction, wink, yeah, please.
Fireworks.
Fireworks. Fireworks. There's also the prospect of possible deeper integration. There's a lot of people that don't know anything about protein discovery and think it's boring altogether. That's possible. I could imagine why. But one of the things that CGP could do is that rats drop DNA parts which you can sell on the market. Protein discovery players could pick up those DNA parts, click on them and get 10 samples, for example. It's one of the ways that they could integrate it more. One of the problems is, with that is that if you change the project to a new one, you have integrated DNA things that drop and you're not researching the project anymore. So it's a bit of a fine line to work on. Difficult ones with some projects. It's also how to call it? A new thing, basically an integrated game. There's very much attention in the science world about this project actually, because of the results it has yielded so far. The amount of players that play it, even though it looks fairly low, is so large that it's already one of the biggest citizen science games ever. And that's just amazing, and that's just because it's integrated into an existing game. So this sets a real standard for some other games. I know that Emma was talking with Bethesda Studios to integrate in a few of their games, and I hope that works, because only a fraction of the, the amount of hours we as EVE players and games in general put, you can only put a single percent of that into, well, analysis of scientific data, we can do real good. But if you do that, the lore tie-in needs to be good. You can't just put a mini game into a game without any sort of bond between it. It explains the why and how, because it would be just weird. And the prospect is there to every year have a new project. I heard they have a few lined up, but I couldn't get any response from CCP Wonderboy on this, so unfortunately, but I hope it is the case. I'll talk to CCP after this talk. Now that I have it on my hands. So basically, that's a short overview of protein discovery and the results has yielded so much, actually, that way earlier than they thought it would be. We completed the entire database, we did it a few times again, and based on that higher consensus amount that we now have, a new atlas is coming out, and a lot of researchers are happy about it, and in effect, people with this disease. So. Yeah, thank you for doing protein discovery if you do it, and if you don't, take another look into it, especially if you talk to the new alpha clone players. It's pretty good money for these guys. After the new NP, I think they end up in factional warfare space. Yeah. Yes, yes. And you lose frigates very fast right there to six sequels. So if you only do 20 images, you have enough for a new frigate, a horribly fit frigate, but you have a frigate. And if they're mining even, tell them about this. It's just a pastime. It delivers a little bit of money, and as you get higher, as I said, because it's broken, you get a whole lot of money. I myself only made a couple of billion about this, but a lot of people have a whole lot more. So that's basically an overview of Project Discovery. Questions. If you have them, if not, that's okay. Then we go on to prizes. But if you have a question,
if you have any questions, you can come to this mic with every presentation. So feel free to come down, ask your question. We'll do it for about like 10 minutes, 15 minutes, depending on how many questions you have.
If there's no
questions.
Hi, thanks for the presentation. I was wondering, how does this compare to CPU-bound research projects, like, for example, looking for cancer cells or predicting the environment and the and stuff?
For the amount of cancer cells, as I said, this is used as a database for a really huge amount of scientists. The number that they check on their website is over 150,000. A lot of those are scientists that do pull requests in the database to get the data out of this. And they wanted more data regarding the subcellular address. And based on this data, we've created that. And that research that will eventually end up in a better treatment. Yeah.
PD is now a separate mini-game. How about integrating it in something like hacking, where you have to solve a couple of samples before you can go on?
That's a very good thing. It was also one of the feedback points when I just did singularity, why separate. The answer is that the learning curve is basically too difficult. The hacking game is for some people already too difficult. get one of the new analyzers, they're cool. But basically, if you have to, most people in NullSec with their interceptors and their relic site, because nobody does data sites, except after Ascension, we get new blueprints, more blueprints. People are going to blitz them and not be accurate enough to confidently hand it over to players. That's a problem, because if you hand over data to people and they just press it as fast as possible, and that coupled with the learning curve, it wasn't a good idea. That's why.
Well, thank you.
Anybody else? Any more questions, guys? I'll give them another round, please.
So, the prices. I would not leave yet if I was you.
Oh, that's Russell.
Yes. So the guy who lost his phone, it's here, so we can pick it up. Otherwise, 5 million. You start with 5 million. All right. So we got some amazing prices. But also, I think I had at least three people who came to me with their little red bands. So if you're here, come to the stage now or after, so we can get your name on the page, and you just won 12 plaques. So. 12 plaques, so a year of playing Eve. And so today, or this time, we got a pirate cruiser pack plus a fitted pirate battleship. I think it's either a Vindicator or a Nightmare. So that's nice. We got a carrier plus 3 plaques, and a Fenrir BPO plus 3 plaques. And they were donated by Fight Blob, person Merc from Above. Again, Merc from Above and Lenny Kravitz. And then we have Marmite Collective, who I think is sitting there. So you can give him an applause for donating. And again, the packs were donated by Lenny Kravitz. So I didn't prepare well enough because obviously I was busy doing other stuff. So let's see which number one. It's 214. Mark Lemberg, are you here? Mark Lemberg, I think there's a hand. Please come to the stage, give him an applause. Also, now that I have your attention, I forgot to mention that G-Fleet sponsored all of the cans, the energy cans of Quave, so thanks to them as well. I forgot that, sorry. Anthony Jackin Raffelt. I'm terrible at pronunciation. Are you here? Anthony.
Antoine Joaquin Bravo.
Ah, cool. Is he here?
No.
I don't think so. Okay. Hold on.
That sucks.
86. So where's the new place? Mike van Kranenburg, are you here?
Oh,
yeah. Give him an applause.
I thought he was pointing at me, right there.
So we have the last one is Robin van Verhoeven, very Dutch name. Are you here? I think I see a hand there. No? No. Oh, next one. Sorry, bad luck. It is Tom Huberty. Huberty? Tom Huberty, are you here? I wish I could keep these prices. Let me see. Martijn Hermans? Are you here? Ah, finally. Okay. So I think the next presentation is at 15:30. It's Spying in Eve. It's a really interesting presentation. Also, I found somebody's passport. No, it's literally somebody found it. So if its name is, let me see.
Charles something.
Yeah, Charles Daniel Goodhand. It's your official name, and he's saying that. So if your phone is also here, so. So yeah, you're free to go now. The next presentation will be there. Eve Valkyrie is playable.